Hey, Miles here, milesbeckler.com. I have my beautiful wife, Melanie, with me here, and today we're going to be doing a deep, deep dive on Pinterest marketing, specifically organic Pinterest marketing. The goal of this video is to save you money and give you, literally, hand over the keys to the castle of a proven kick-ass Pinterest marketing method, so you don't need to go buy any overpriced courses, and we're going to jump in and just lay it all out and let you really know what you need to do. So the first question is, and I'm going to pose this to you, Melanie, why Pinterest?
Why Pinterest? Okay, so I love Pinterest, and I really like Pinterest for a few reasons. So first of all, what is Pinterest? If you're not a Pinterest user, you may be asking yourself that question. Not only will it work for you, but what the heck is it? So Pinterest, as Pinterest describes it, is a visual search engine. So instead of when you search for something in Google and you get like the Google list, the search results, in Pinterest you get a visual layout of images. These are pins. And the way it was explained to me is that pins are like doors. So each pin is a door to your blog. And hopefully it's a relevant door to exactly what you're linking to. So the first reason I like Pinterest is it is building a ton of bridges to my content on my site. Or to keep with the language I started using, it's opening doors towards my site. The other reason I like it is that my people are on Pinterest. The demographics of Pinterest are largely women, and really women who have money. One of the common ways that people use Pinterest is to create topical boards. So if I was going to refurnish my living room, I might pin the couch I want, the coffee table I want, the lamp I want, the paint color I want, and then when it's go time, I can actually click through all of those doors and directly order all of those individual pieces. So people are not only on Pinterest looking around for cool stuff, but they're categorizing stuff with the intent to buy. So the intent to purchase is there.
Right. So real quick, we've got a few major benefits, and it's worth reiterating, and you nailed it. Thank you. That was a beautiful description. So number one, she talked about how it creates these bridges to her content on her website. This is huge SEO value. These are actually backlinks, and we're going to tell you how to structure your Pinterest account in a way to get these backlinks through what they call rich pins. But there's a second benefit, which is literally directly tapping into the Pinterest user base. So I looked today in the most recent statistics I could find, 150 million active users, monthly active users on Pinterest, 81% of which are women. And as you said, they're generally speaking skewed a little bit more towards the affluent side of things when you compare to the other social networks. It's kind of the more affluent social network. So you're able to present your content and get two types of wins, especially if you're targeting women, right? Because that's the biggest size of the demographic. You get the win of getting your content and your information out to this user base of 150 million users, and you get the SEO value linking back to your WordPress site in order to get those kind of backlinks from the rich pins. So beautifully, beautifully stated. I thank you for that. So in moving forward, let's talk about this rich pin idea. The first thing that people need to do is obviously set up a Pinterest account themselves. And then how do we get the rich pins activated and working?
So when he says rich pin, when you have a rich, okay, so a normal pin is this rectangular shaped image.
Kind of a vertical.
Vertical image.
Rectangle.
Ideally 1100 by 700 pixels for like the most real estate. You can go taller than that, and I have gone taller than that with infographics that work really well on Pinterest as well, but kind of as a standard, I use that 1100 by 700.
So 1100
size.
Tall and 700 wide.
1100 pixels tall and 700 pixels wide.
Perfect.
Giving you that beautiful little Pinterest rectangle.
Right.
So as a normal Pinterest user, you can upload those pins to Pinterest and choose a page on your site to open that door to. If you have your Pinterest account verified as a business account, which is easy to do, figure out how to do that, you can then display your metadata from the site. So you want to make sure that your WordPress site has like the Yoast plugin, or you have some way, if you're using Squarespace, I think there's also another way, some way that each of your blog posts has the title, the description, and then that information will actually show up under your pin, which is essentially just giving you more real estate on Pinterest. But also, and we'll probably be talking more about this shortly, say I have a blog post, 7 signs your angels are with you. I'll probably have one pin that literally says like 7 signs your angels are with you, but then I can also create multiple pins for that post, one for each of the sign. So like I could make a pin that says when feathers appear, angels are near, and then underneath that, the description shows up 7 signs your angels are with you. So it's like more information for the user about where that pin leads. And it also puts your profile image there, your profile name, just giving you more brand authority, giving you more visibility on Pinterest. So that's an essential for Pinterest marketing, is to get your account verified.
Right. And so it's twofold again. And you're noticing like Pinterest has layers and layers of benefit. So you get more real estate, and obviously pushing your competitors off of the search results on Pinterest page is a goal. But then you get that extra little bit of text that creates relevance to the content it's linking to. There's SEO benefit there, but you can also use compelling text to encourage the user to click, increasing the click-through rate and increasing the potential traffic. So real quick, I want to jump into some data. So we really dug in on Pinterest November-ish. We really kind of like tripled down. Melanie's seen this coming from a long way. I was hesitant, to be honest, but once I saw the data in, I believe, October, we really kind of implemented this strategy and we've been running it. It's now March as of this recording, so that's about 5 or 6 months. We are getting about 55,000 visits per month from Pinterest to our website, and that is resulting in hundreds upon hundreds. I believe just over 1% of those are subscribing to our list. It was higher when we had a full screen pop-up on our list. Right now we just have a top ribbon, and we're gonna keep testing that, and there's a good chance we can get that up to 1,000 plus subscribers per month. And again, this has pretty much been free to set up and implement. So then we taught this strategy to our friends in New Zealand during our mastermind in December, and they started with literally no traffic, and they were getting literally 1 to 5 subscribers per week. And then we taught them this exact plan and program we're going to teach you. They implemented it. It's now 3 months later. They're getting 6,000 visits per month to their website from zero, practically, right? So a massive increase in traffic. These are highly targeted people, and they're getting hundreds upon hundreds of subscribers, taking them up on their opt-in from Pinterest at this point. And it fits with their niche, right? It's focused on the female demographic, a little bit older, people who have money, so it really works for them. But this is why we're teaching this to you now, is because we implemented it ourselves. We got really good results. We taught in a very close, this exact plan with our friends. They've gotten really good results with it. So now it's time for us to kind of spill the beans and throw it out there to the world.
Yeah, and that kind of reminded me of one thing that I think is really powerful about Pinterest compared to other social networks, is like that on Facebook or Instagram or Snapchat, you're really only seeing the content from people who you follow. Instagram has a pretty good like explore feature, but the huge limitation of not being able to directly link to the site. So Pinterest, I'm getting like way more traffic than the number of followers I have reflects. So you can follow Pinterest, but this isn't the most, you can follow Pinterest users, but this isn't the most common behavior. It's the power of it is that it's really this visual search engine. And so people can type in, like I'll type in crystals, and then all of these crystals from different users who I'm not even following appear. I can then pin that to my board And then when I do that, everyone who is following me is more likely to see that pin. So Pinterest just has this like filtering out quality of just like getting your content out there. It's
an audience growth engine in many senses. It connects you with new people who you're not connected with versus only, like on Facebook, you're only showing to the people you're connected with. Instagram, mostly the hashtags kind of work beyond that. But as you said, there's not the link out possibility on Instagram.
Yeah, and then we kind of mentioned SEO, search engine optimization, at the beginning. And in addition to the direct traffic that we're seeing from Pinterest, I really feel, and I don't have like an exact metric for this, but that the Google organic traffic has also significantly climbed as a result of building all of these doors to Pinterest.
Right.
And I think that's because Pinterest is a high authority site, and so I'm building a lot of relevant links, deep linking to my content, which Google likes to see. Yeah. And so not only am I getting more direct traffic from Pinterest to my 7 signs your angels are with you post, but then that's actually moved up in the Google rankings. So when people search that on Google or Pinterest, it's just more flow towards the post, which is ultimately what we want to see to our content, getting it out there.
Absolutely. Great point. So let's look into how to structure this, right? So they've got an account on Pinterest now at this point, and then they've gone in and verified as a business account. If you don't know how to do that, go to Pinterest, search for how to verify. It's super easy on Google. They'll show you how. At this point, they've got their brand, they've got their products, and they want to get their stuff out. So there's two levels to Pinterest, right? There's boards and there's pins. So how should they structure this just before they really kind of implement this program? What's the foundation that they need to lay first?
Okay, so your Pinterest account is going to be categorized into boards. This is totally up to you to create, and it's up to you the number of boards you have. So I would recommend getting clear about what kind of assets you have for your business. If your blog is already clearly broken up into different categories, you probably want a board for each of those categories. So my blog, I have broken up, there's like angel messages, angel card readings, and then my blog. So I have a different board for each of those categories. Then in addition, what else do you do, or what else is highly relevant to your business, to your brand? I would say ideally you have at least 8 boards. And so if you have 3 for your blog, then maybe 1 that is going to be other people's content as well as your content. So for me, that would be crystals is another category where I pin other people's pictures of crystals as well as my direct pins back to my blog. I can't figure this out for you.
Right. It's all about relevance, really, right? Like, what are those? So you have your core, and you want to get as many boards as you can based around your core, around the core categories, right? The 3 or 4 entrance points. But then it's like, what are the other things that your people, your target audience that you're being of service to, what else are they interested in? And have some boards about that also. And feel free to have, like, lifestyle boards, too. Like, it doesn't need to be super businessy. You can have some, like, real world, some kind of, like, dream vacation spots boards and stuff to really kind of like round it out.
Right, but it should be relevant. And so so my brand is all about connecting with spirit, connecting with angels. So I do kind of have like the dream vacations board, but I have spiritual travel destinations. And so I'll pin like pictures from sacred sites, and then also my pins that are linking back to like my article about Sedona vortexes or these sorts of things. So let's talk about pins really quick. So you have your boards, you have the infrastructure, and then there's 2 different ways that you can fill those boards up. And the first is your own pins. Those doors back to your blog posts, back to your products, back to your articles. And even in that, there's a couple of different ways you can do that. So Miles is going to help make sure that we get this out clearly.
Here to
so
help.
The way I like to do this, and I think the best practice, is to have at least 1 pin, that pin-sized image, on your actual blog post, or product. So add the full 700 by 1100 pixel image to your blog. Add it in full size and then resize it down to whatever
to where it
actually
fits.
Looks good. Yep. I usually resize it down to about 280 pixels. Doing that after adding the full image so that the full image will be able to be pinned to Pinterest. So what this does is allows the readership you already have on your blog to pin your content to their board. So this is an important step, and you want that to happen.
And there's a plugin, if I may just interject real quick, there's a WordPress plugin, it's called like the Pin It plugin, and anytime a mouse hovers over an image on your website, it shows a little pin thing, and Pinterest users know that little red P, and they click, and they can go pin it to the board, but you first pin it to your own board through that functionality once you publish your site, and that's the first step.
Yeah, so the first step is to put it on your actual blog and pin it to Pinterest. Now, you have the option to create more hidden pins for that blog post. So like I mentioned, the seven steps or seven signs you're connecting with your angels, I pin that first main image, but then I could create 10 more pins that aren't gonna go on the blog post, but that I just upload directly to Pinterest, and ideally schedule these to Pinterest, which we're gonna talk about the best way how to manage your scheduling.
We got some automation coming up. Yep.
And there's lots of different schedulers, but there's a key reason why you want to use the one I use, so we'll tell you about that shortly. But so then you would schedule out those 10 pins to drip out to your Pinterest, all linking back to that original blog post. Did that make sense?
Yep, totally. So step one, you put it in your content, you publish your content, all SEO rich, your Yoast SEO title and description are in, and you have the Pinterest plugin, and then you go load that like a user loads your webpage, your blog post, and you click pin, and you pin it like a user would, and then everyone else who finds that can do it. Then you also schedule out 5 to 10 additional pins for that piece of content to go out once a week or whatever your schedule is, and we'll talk about that in the future. That way you're getting more doors re-entering people into your main piece of content. These are all of the different backlinks that you get through Pinterest, but it's also individual doors about different components of that article. So when people are using the Pinterest as a search engine, which it is, they're able to find your content and find your content that way. So it helps you on Google and it helps you on Pinterest.
Okay, yeah. And so that using Pinterest as a search engine. So you can use one or two hashtags. I think you can only use one hashtag on Pinterest if you want to be able to boost your Pinterest posts, which that's kind of a whole other topic. But hashtags really are not the core of Pinterest. Pinterest catalogs the search results based on your both your description in your rich pin and then also your caption that you type into Pinterest. So as much as you can, make sure that those captions are both headline worthy and enticing them to click, but also keyword rich with the relevant keywords that you've identified using Keyword Finder and the keyword research tool.
And the video that we did. Yeah, I did that.
Keyword research.
So it's that game of it needs to be, you know, like user friendly in order to say compelling and make them click, but it also has to be kind of search engine friendly to have it keyword based. And you got to find that balance.
And the other side is that Pinterest has its own categories. So for a while I was pinning quotes to like inspiration, and then I realized, oh, there's this whole words of wisdom category. So play around with Pinterest, typing in your different keywords, see what pops up, and try to get your stuff to show up under those categories just through being relevant to that. And if you need to use like one hashtag to get one more word in there that doesn't make sense in your description, then that's when you use that one hashtag.
Right, but it's not hashtag stuffing like Instagram is by any means.
No, not at all. Like you don't search by hashtags.
And really, I think it's important to use and become a practitioner of Pinterest. I mean, like I'm using YouTube, right? Like I've created 180 videos in like 7 or 8 months. Like you need to go use the platform. So at this point, you've got your core, your business verified, you've got your core boards set up, and the kind of next step I think would be to add something like 10 pins that are relevant to each board just to populate them. Do you think 10 is enough just to kind of get that core start?
10 pins for each board. I mean, for a course start, but ideally your Pinterest is having new content.
Well, we're
going to
talk about how that's
going to
happen next.
And so when you say to have 10 pins to start, I think a great way to start is to like alternate and mix in other pins that you haven't created in with your
stuff.
Own
yep.
that are super relevant and that makes sense in that category. So that's a good way to fill your boards out initially.
And to get experience on the platform. So what we're saying is when you're in Pinterest, and let's say you're on the Pinterest app on your phone, and you search in keyword research, which why would you ever search that? Crystals, right?
Keyword
you're going to see a list of images that make sense to crystals. You can click the repin button and repin it to your own board. And that's how you do this first fill out kind of process mixed in with some of your content, linking back to your product pages on Shopify or your WordPress blog posts and to your other content marketing assets, essentially.
Yeah, and just to clarify, like Pinterest is not all spiritual niche at all. In fact, that's kind of like a way smaller segment within Pinterest. I've been telling Miles he should get on Pinterest more because there's a huge how to blog, how to build your business side of Pinterest, huge fashion, home, retail, like look around, but I'd say there's a good chance that even if your audience leans more towards male, there's still a good probability that Pinterest is going to be beneficial.
And the male demographic is growing. It's definitely catching on in many senses because it is a great tool. So I'm personally using it for summer's coming up, camping season, and we're getting ready to get some camping gear. And I'm looking through and finding the little stove that I want, and I put it in my camping gear board, and I put all these little things I want that I'm planning on getting in my camping board. It's not time for me to buy them yet, and then when the time's right, I'm like, okay, cool, I know to go straight to that camping board, and there's all the things that I want in order to purchase it. I can literally click through the rich pins and go to whoever pinned that originally, go to their site and purchase that item right then and there. And that's how this flows customers back to you, or if you're an affiliate, it can flow customers to the affiliate link, the affiliate program or network that you're promoting, etc. So let's get in. Are we ready to get into automation, or is there anything else?
No, we have one.
Cool.
Not yet. So because we're talking about populating your boards, what is the best practices for creating your actual pins? So I mentioned 700 by 1100. Also, I highly recommend that all of your pins have a similar branding feel to your brand. So you want to make sure that you're using the colors that correspond with your brand. If your brand is like really bright and flashy, make sure your pins are really bright and flashy.
Yep.
I did not start off in this direction. So if you look at my Pinterest account, I'm kind of like all over the place, but I've really dialed this in recently, and I recommend you do it from the start. It's really, so like I would recommend creating or having a designer create for you or work with Canva to create like 7 to 10 different Pinterest templates that are all different and unique, maybe different colors or different styles, but that are using the same fonts, that have your logo on it, that really have the feel of your brand. And then you can customize and kind of cycle through those templates so that you have a variety of different looking pins, but someone who falls in love with your brand, which is the ultimate goal here, can see a pin of yours and recognize it as yours at a glance, and they're like, oh, I love their content. I haven't seen this post, pin, click, buy, etc.
Right. So that's really powerful. And what that is it's using like the same fonts, the same colors, the same similar layouts done in a couple of different ways to where when Pinterest users load the app, they get a feed showing up. And if they see your colors and your template in a new variation they haven't seen, they're going to have that moment of, oh, I like this brand. I trust this brand. What do they got going on? And they're going to be more likely to click through. Fiverr would be a great place to go get some inexpensive ones. Only use people on Fiverr who have very high numbers of jobs completed with high star ratings. Upwork is a place you can go find graphics design help, or Canva is a very good web-based, simple yet functional kind of graphics design software that would allow you to do it yourself if you need to kind of DIY and bootstrap this. Cool. Are we ready to get an automation?
Okay, now we can talk about
automation. But before we get an automation, so we're going to get an automation next, and then after we're going to go how to leverage other people's efforts on Pinterest.
Which is like super advanced key for this
stuff.
Strategy.
It is key. So we'll get there, but this is phase two now. So we finished phase one, which is like foundation, and now we're in phase two, which is automation, right? So I guess it starts with secret boards. What's the first part of automation?
Okay, so the tool that I like to use for automating Pinterest.
We have turkeys up on the hill. If you can hear the gobbling.
I hope you can hear that. I'm sure
you can. If not, we're just giggling on camera because there's turkeys gobbling. But let's keep going.
Okay, so the turkeys totally made me lose my train of thought.
Board Booster is the tool.
Board Booster is the tool, yes. So the way Board Booster works is you create secret boards, and then you can fill up your secret boards, and then Board Booster will schedule those out depending on whatever schedule you set up. So that's like the most basic feature of Board Booster, and the part of it that there's like 25 other softwares that you could do that with, but you want to use Board Booster because of its additional functionality that we'll get to
next.
But to schedule out your pins. So when you're pinning your own content, you're pinning other people's content, scheduling allows you to spend like an hour a week and have consistent ongoing updates to your Pinterest account appearing, because Pinterest does really, you know, like all of the social networks kind of prioritize what's new, fresh, and hot. Yep. And so scheduling out continually puts that new content out there.
Right. And so what she's talking about is we're able to batch the work in a major way. So
yeah.
You can literally go in on like Sunday afternoon and you can spend an hour or 2 hours and populate your secret boards, and then over the course of the week till next Sunday, till you batch your work next, Board Booster will automatically drip those out based on the schedule that you pre-populate to all of the different boards, saving you a lot of time. So you don't have to go into Pinterest 3 or 4 times a day, because that becomes a distraction at that point, and you really need to stay kind of like focused on batch the work, get it done in a major way. I want to go a little deeper into the secret board concept, right? So we have in Pinterest, like, you're going to have board A, board B, board C, etc. You're going to name them topically based, right? I'm just using examples. But then what you do is you go inside of your Pinterest account and you make board A-secret, board B-secret. So you actually have every single board that you're going to be continuing to grow with pins, you have a secret version of it. You have it turned to secret so only you can see it, and you name it the same thing with dash secret at the end.
I would say rather than dash secret, what helps to really make it visible so you can see at a glance is to put a dash before the name.
Bingo.
So like if I have spiritual guidance blog, then I have dash spiritual guidance
right.
blog.
So, the one with the minus in front of it is
the
secret one.
Secret board. And that just makes it easy.
It makes it totally easy. And that's a brilliant kind of a hack as someone, because you're definitely the practitioner on this.
Yeah.
I'm behind it and I'm excited to share this stuff. So what you're doing then is you'll have your 8 boards, then you'll have the 8 correlated corresponding secret boards. Then on Sunday or whenever it works for you, you go in and you put, you know how many you need, right? If you're doing 10 per day per board, you know you need 70 per secret category, so it can drip out 7 times 10, right? 7 days, 10 per day. And you have full control over this. You're controlling the frequency. You can do 5 a day per board, 2, 3, 7, 10, 20, whatever you would like. But then you go in and you populate your secret boards. They get real fat and heavy. And one by one, on the schedule that you set up, Board Booster will place those in the right spaces for you.
Yeah, the one limitation on your scheduling is that you do need to fill up your secret boards in order. They don't have a shuffle feature, so just take that in mind. So rather than creating 10 pins for one blog post, go through and create one pin for 10 blog posts, and then do another loop through.
Right.
So
you're not
going
to have
more variety. So it's not like just same thing, same thing, same thing, which doesn't have an organic natural user feel.
Right, right. So you got to populate those secret boards in a kind of a random order. You have to take control of that in order for it to display out to the end users in said random order. So you're not kind of firing off like on the new living room idea. You don't want it to go out lamp, 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 lamp. You want it to be lamp, rug, couch, painting. I'm out of
keeping it looking and feeling as natural as possible, even though we're automating it. So the campaigns in Board Booster are how you schedule out your posts, allowing you to batch your work, which is key for consistency and longevity,
yeah,
which is also key to really making Pinterest work for you. It's not about pinning 500 things today and then being like, okay, I'm done. But with scheduling, you actually can pin 500 things today to your secret boards and have those set up to drip out.
Right.
So before we get to groups, the next really cool feature of Board Booster is called their looping feature. So I mentioned how Pinterest does prioritize new content. So in addition to scheduling your campaigns, you then want to set up a looping function, which will... And this is all customizable. So I have like on one of my boards 5 times a day. And this is because this is a big board with probably like 200 posts. And so 5 times a day staggered is going to take my older posts and repin them to the top. And then after 2 days, it will delete whichever of those posts has gone less viral.
Which has less engagement.
Less repins.
Right.
And likes and engagement. So the looping feature is another way to increase your frequency of pinning, which is important, without requiring a ton more work for
from you. Yeah.
Did that make sense?
It does, I think. And you're getting a lot longer term benefits from the same amount of content. So you're using Board Booster at this point. We're going to add a third use in a moment. But at this point, number one is you're taking all the content you're pre-populating in your secret boards and you're moving that up to your live boards on a schedule. And it's doing that automated. Then the second thing it does is it takes some of those things it's already pinned for you back over the last couple of weeks and months and it repins them as new pins. And then to make sure that it doesn't put up duplicate content on your account, it measures after 2 days which one has more engagement, which one has lower engagement, the newer or the older. It deletes the one with the lower engagement and leaves the one with the newer engagement. And again, you have all sorts
with
of tweaks.
Engagement.
And, yeah, it keeps the one with more engagement live.
So it is important if you're going to use this strategy that all of your pins are evergreen. So don't put up a bunch of pins like March 2017, blah, blah, blah. Like,
right.
It needs to be more evergreen, which really is more of how Pinterest works anyway. So if you do have date-specific stuff, you probably want to go in and manually delete it once it's no longer relevant. Otherwise,
yep,
your Pinterest account is just clogged up with that. So I only put one thing that's like date specific and it's on my angel card readings. I do like a weekly angel card reading. I have those going up as just square posts that then square posts don't loop. So those are never getting repinned as new. Only my vertical posts are getting looped and repinned.
That's pretty advanced strategy. So you can change the shape of the image you're using and then Board Booster will know not to repost those.
You have the ability to loop all sizes or to only loop rectangular sizes. So I'm only looping rectangular sizes, giving myself the opportunity to do some date specific stuff on Pinterest without looping it.
Really powerful concept right there.
Okay. Can we talk about the cool part?
The coolest cool part,
coolest
absolutely.
Part?
Are we getting into the groups?
Yeah, I think so, unless
yep,
there's
no,
something
absolutely.
Else that we
I think
should
it's,
cover first.
I think it's a good time. So on Pinterest, there's group boards, right? And we've already talked to you about how you're going to build out your own boards, but what you can do is you can go find, is it called Pin...
I forgot to look. Pin Groupie.
Pingroupie.com is the free tool.
I'm 97% sure. We'll link to it
below. It'll be in the links below. So Pingroupie.com is a tool that allows you to go find group boards on topics that are of interest to your target market.
So what is the topic that your brand is associated with? If it's outdoor gear, you probably have a lot more options than I do for group boards, but I would look for outdoor gear,
camping,
outdoors,
hiking,
camping, yeah, all of these things to find groups. Really, the way the group board works is one person starts it, and then they're able to invite people to collaborate on the board. So you're getting added to a group board allows you to pin to that board that maybe already has 20,000 followers, increasing the number of people who are going to see your doors right away.
Right.
So Pin Groupie allows you to search and find boards. You are looking for boards that are highly engaged. There are boards out there. I actually got into a board that has like 100,000 followers, but it has so many different people pinning all the time that nothing's really getting repinned. It's just the engagement is super low. And I'm seeing far better results from much smaller group boards where the members and the audience is much more engaged. So engagement is bigger, is more important than
size.
The size.
How do you tell where the engagement is? Or is that from?
It's a functionality of the Pin Groupie.
Got it. So in Pin Groupie, when you search for something, it's going to tell you the engagement amount, and it's going to tell you the size.
In Board Booster, so you can jump into a board and then monitor it, and it will show you the engagement. So like the big board I mentioned I was a part of, I just recently kind of decided like, okay, this probably isn't worth it. Like my stuff's just not getting seen there. So you can kind of analyze after the fact if it's working. Okay. But ideally, you want to join like 3 hyper-relevant group boards to start. And the way you join them is you first find them. So you can search via Pin Groupie, but also be a user on Pinterest. Not all relevant groups are categorized on Pin Groupie, and some of the best group boards I found just from browsing Pinterest. You can, if you find a group board, see who in that group board is actively pinning, then go look at their profile and see are they in any other group boards, and identify some hyper relevant is key group boards that your content would just be a perfect fit for, would really give value to that group board. So you identify the group board, and then you need to actually reach out to the group owner and ask for them to invite you to be a part of the group board.
Hey, I saw your group board. It looks great. I'm in the same niche. I'm interested in being a contributor type situation.
The way Pinterest works is the way Pinterest group boards work is typically the admin of the board will put a little instruction in the bio of how to request to be added. So follow that. If they say to email them at this address, do that. If they say to comment on their most recent post, do that. If they say to message them, do that.
And two really important things. I want to just jump in real quick. Number one, you said you have to be giving value to these groups. Like, you really have to come from a place of value. If you go in and think you're going to be tapping into this audience and you're going to spam them, or even if you don't consider it spamming, but you're going to put promotion after promotion after product after product after product, they're going to boot you in an instant. You have to give value. That's why linking to your content is so powerful and your content is so good. We've covered this in all the other videos, but I had to reiterate that for a moment, that the goal is to be of service and give of your unique content to this kind of captive audience there on this board. Number two, you really want to have your Pinterest profile and your boards and things set up before you start reaching out to these group people, because they're going to go look at you. They're going to be like, okay, is this person like a real Pinterest user? Because they're shy. They know there's people out there who are like, aha, Pinterest, I could go spam that platform. Oh, spam.
There are Pinterest spammers.
Totally. They're out there, and these group people have seen it, and they're doing everything they can to kind of like weed them out. So become a product of the product, use Pinterest, grow your boards, get the board booster stuff going phase one, phase two first, then really focus on giving a value to those groups. And that's how it ultimately works, is it becomes a part of your content marketing strategy that just lets you leverage other audiences. So I just wanted to clarify.
Yeah, that's good clarification. So identify the group boards that are a perfect fit for your brand, reach out to the admin in the way that they suggest or recommend. I would recommend you keep your outreach simple. Don't go on and on about how amazing their board is. Just say, hey, I like your board, call it by its name, and I would love to contribute some of my best posts. If you follow the board and follow the person, it makes it super easy for them to add you. So follow the person, follow the board, request to be added, and then it's kind of just a waiting game, but typically if it's an adding board, people will add you very quickly. Once you are in the board,
this is where it gets good.
You're going to use the same looping strategy of Board Booster in order to loop the posts you've already scheduled that are already live on your Pinterest profile to that group. So you will select you can choose on a board basis. So like, okay, I just got added to the Dream Living Room group. I'm going to loop my Dream Living Room board and not my Dream Kitchen board, for example.
Relevance.
Maybe you have a few different boards that really funnel into that one group perfectly. You can loop all of those to that group, figuring out your frequency, and a lot of the group admins will give guidance on this as well. Please limit your contribution to 5 posts a day, pin as much as you want. Okay, so set that up with your frequency and say you do 5 posts a day. Check back in a day, check back in 2 days, check back in a week, and really just monitor to make sure that your content is coming out at a frequency in
balance
with the other group members. So the goal here is not to take over the group board by any means. It's to be a part of and be integrated into the group. So ideally, you should have a pin, and then other people should have pins, and then you should have a pin.
If you go back and you see your pin, you're really close to getting booted from that, and they probably won't notify you if and when they're going to boot you.
So you would want to decrease your frequency then. Even if they say 5 pins a day are cool, if you're like 5 pins in a row, decrease your frequency. Right. Because the board booster looping feature, you would want to set it up to loop at an interval between like 8 a.m. and midnight. So it's spreading all of your posts out, giving other contributors a chance to pin in between.
And the frequency is literally something you just set inside of Board Booster. So at this point in phase 3, this is kind of the big way that you're using Board Booster, and it's the looping feature, right? Not the new post feature. So to kind of give an overview of how all this works is you set up your Pinterest account, you get your boards, then you get your secret boards, which you populate with lots of your content, and it can be other people's content. Then Board Booster takes those secret board pins and drips them out to your main boards on that schedule based on the frequency that you set it up. Then it loops, Board Booster being it, Board Booster loops your own pins back on your boards, and it can loop those pins onto relevant group boards also, leaving you in a position that all you really have to do is obviously set it up, but then you still stay focused 100% on growing these secret boards, keeping those full, and everything else happens with automation from there. You need to check in on your frequencies, make sure in the group boards that you're being an average participant. That's, you know, you want to deliver above average content, but not above average frequency. And it's that idea of value, right? Like, think of a group board. It's a group of administrators working together to be of service to a group of people who like a topic. You need to present and go about this and approach this in a way to, you want to be of service to the group administrators, which means you're giving the best content out there, and you want to be of service to the group itself, meaning you're giving them the best content you have, and when you do that right, they're going to go reverse engineer it and be like, dude, every time this person posts, I love their post. They're going to follow you, they're going to look at your other pins, they're going to click through to your blog post because they're going to feel the integrity, and they're going to feel the value that you're giving, and that is how you can go leverage the audiences that have been grown in these groups and bring them all the way back to essentially to your email list at the farthest step through multiple points.
Oh yeah, and that kind of reminded me of one more thing. I have decided to start my own group board as well, which I would recommend that you do as well. It's just a great way to give back to the community. And then also, there's a chance that your group board will take off and grow at a faster rate than your profile. And so it's just going to increase the visibility of your profile even when other users' pins are the ones that get that are going viral because they're on your group board.
Right, because
so
you own
in addition it. To joining group boards, start a group board, and then when you're in the group board you've joined, you can reach out to certain people who you really like their posts and say, like, hey, I'm running this group board. I would love for you to contribute. You want to creating a board with the idea that you'll turn it into a group board, but let it gain a little more momentum before you start following people.
That's brilliant. That's brilliant. And that's kind of like it puts you in the authoritative position. Yeah. It puts you in control of all the dials, and it's really your situation. Obviously, Pinterest owns it, but you're in full control of the asset, and it's a really powerful way. On your group board, did you kind of do research and try to find something that there wasn't a group board on? Are there other group boards that are very similar to your group board? You're just started another one, or was it kind of like a new positioning, new tweak on a group board?
It was kind of like my twist on... There aren't a ton of huge group boards in my niche.
Your space, yeah.
And so I was just like, I kind of made like a compilation. So like any posts about these number of things, like it's not super specific. It's more just like a spirituality board, an
cool
awakening board. So like positive, uplifting. And I suggest to limit posts to 5 times a day, which seems to like be a good balance in there for the size of the group.
Cool.
Yeah. Anything else?
So one other thing about Pinterest I want to make sure is clear is, so there are doors back to your website ultimately, right? Like the goal is, it is a traffic generation system. Yes, we're growing an audience there. Yes, we're being of service, but ultimately we're getting people to click through. Now on the Pinterest app, and most Pinterest users are on mobile, most of them, when they click on a link, it's going to load in a Pinterest browser. And the Pinterest browser may work a little bit differently than Google Chrome or Safari or Internet Explorer. So you need to make sure on your website that you either have a big pop-up that shows up that offers your opt-in, or a ribbon up top, or a fly-in at the bottom. If you don't know what these things are, they're all available inside of Thrive Themes. It's the theme that we use for our websites. It's the theme that we recommend you use on WordPress. But the reason I'm mentioning this is when we first laid out this plan for our friends in New Zealand, they were rolling with it, and he's like, yeah, but I'm not getting any opt-ins. And I was like, well, do you have a pop-up? Do you have a ribbon? And he's like, no, I don't. He turned that on and boom, instantly it went up to like 300-400 opt-ins per month from that point on. So you got to have, you could just kind of like test it on your own phone and make sure that your opt-in mechanism on your website functions inside of the Pinterest browser, because when they click on Pinterest, it's not like it opens up the browser on their phone. It uses the Pinterest native browser.
And if your website's not loading well in the Pinterest native browser, it's probably not loading well in the Facebook native browser either. So
probably not mobile friendly.
Like mobile friendly is absolutely key. If your website is not mobile friendly,
get on to Thrive. Get on to Thrive with
Make
WordPress.
Make it mobile friendly.
I'll link to that. It has to be.
Yeah.
Wow. Thank you very much.
Okay. One more thing before
yes.
we part.
Bonus. So bonus round.
I mentioned that you can pin your pins as well as like other images and things onto your board. A couple of things on those other images and things. You can get the Pinterest app for your phone to make repinning easy, pinning to your secret boards. There's also a Chrome browser. So if you're browsing around and there's like an article that you really like, pin that to
your
Chrome
board. Browser extension.
Chrome browser extension.
And so you install an extension on your Chrome browser, and it's called the Pinterest Pin It extension?
So what this does is, even if someone doesn't have a Pinterest functionality on their website, you can still repin their images.
Every image on every web page on the webosphere becomes
National
pinnable.
Geographic, they somehow blocked you from pinning.
Oh,
but
interesting.
Anyway,
side note.
So, and then the one other thing I wanted to mention is that you can pin directly, like, to Amazon affiliate links. So, like, I could probably do this a little bit better, like, on my crystals board, would be to actually pin crystals that are for sale on Amazon. Now, when you pin it, you then need to go in and edit the pin and change the link to the affiliate link. Also, when you upload a pin directly from your browser, it adds like your default web address. So upload the pin and then edit the pin and put in the deep link that is the relevant link back to your website.
So it puts the homepage address?
Yeah, it puts like your default. So when you pin, from your website, you don't have to worry about that. But if you're like uploading the hidden pins I mentioned, 10 more pins linking back to your website, you need to click edit and change the website to the specific deep link that you want it to
be. It's always relevance. It's always about getting to not just your homepage. You need to get to that exact product or that exact blog post.
Yeah.
And the affiliate thing, that's pretty new, to be able to add affiliate links on through Pinterest. That I think they just launched that 3 or 4 months ago. And like books, if there's a category of books or books and products, etc., you can have a category that shows all the products and the things you use. They can click the link below. It just says visit. They click the visit link. They go to where they can check out, and it plants that affiliate cookie, and they have the opportunity to click through and purchase right then and there. This is it. I mean, this is the full strategy, top to bottom. It requires a little foundation, and then you got a couple of phases of using Board Booster. We have an affiliate link to Board Booster that will be in the description below. It gives you, I think, 1,000 free pins. It gives you a free trial. We'll call it that. It's not a monthly thing. It gives you a little bit of a free trial, and you only pay for all the repins you use. So if you have a smaller frequency, you don't pay as much as if you have a big, massive frequency that you're using,
which is
great.
Yeah, and then when you burn through that free trial, Board Booster works on credits.
So you would need to
buy like 1,000 credits, and you use a credit each time a pin is looped or scheduled, but really it seems very comparable price-wise with any other scheduler. And the key thing here is those other schedulers don't have the looping feature, which is what I really love about Pinterest, because it allows you to automate syndicating your content out to those key groups you found.
That's huge.
Immediately increasing your reach.
Right.
And then it also allows you to loop your own content, increasing the new freshness and noteworthy, and
saving how many new things you have to create each week. You get a little extra use out of every time you publish something that your graphics person or you create in Canva, because it's looping it, so it eases the burden a little bit. But the goal with this kind of a strategy is to allow you in one day to go dig in, dive deep, spend an hour or two, fill up your secret boards, and then walk away. And just make sure you do what you need to do enough to where that trickles out and everything happens with automation. You know, I really feel like Pinterest is one of the last organic opportunities to tap into massive audience growth right now in this day and age. Facebook has absolutely crushed audience growth. Twitter is absolutely dead. Instagram, you can get audience growth, but to get the traffic and the opt-ins and the conversions is actually really difficult on Instagram. And Pinterest is that sweet spot. I mean, at 50-something, 55,000 visits a month for us, it's definitely the number two social media network that we're using. We're not doing any follow-unfollow on it at all. We literally, like, we're doing, like, everything we just mentioned is all we're doing on Pinterest, right? Like, nothing's hidden, nothing's here. There's no need to go buy a big expensive course, because this is really the core. This is how the game works if you're going to use Pinterest. I think it's a worthy use of time. I didn't at all times. Melanie gets to say, I told you so.
Happened a few times.
It has happened many times. She saw it from the brand value early. It took me a while to see the numbers in analytics to prove what she knew was happening. And a lot of users are going in that direction. And one more thing.
If you're brand new to Pinterest, like you don't even have a Pinterest account, definitely get on there and browse around, search for your key phrases and keywords and categories, and just really understand how Pinterest works, how users operate, because the goal here is really not to look like a business. Oh, that's why I started to say that. So you have your name And I, so like my brand, my website is ask-angels.com. So my Pinterest is Ask Angels with Melanie Beckler. Like I have my face as my profile picture, and I think it's,
be a real person.
I think it's good to be a real person on Pinterest. There are some people who recommend that you essentially like keyword stuff your description. I don't recommend this either. I think putting a description of what you are, so like this is the number one site for beautiful, and then get keywords in there, living room furniture, the best couches, that kind of thing, but don't just like keyword stuff your, like be real, have fun with it, be authentic, give value, and get your message out there.
Remember that there's 150 million people on it.
Yeah,
they're
like
real people. Right? Like the whole goal is to put all this out. We want to use automation so you can batch the work and you can like get as much leverage as you can for the effort you're putting in. But every pin you put up, everything you put up, remember they're real people that you're, they're your audience. They're your customer avatar and your goal is to be of service to them through getting them the cool content, the cool blog posts, the tips, the inspirational messages, whatever that is for you. And I mean, I guarantee if you follow this plan, if you work this plan and set it up, it's going to be, you know, it's all new up front. But once you get it set up, the results are massive and they're long term. And we're pretty hands off. How long do you spend in Pinterest every week at this point? And we have our VAs doing most of it, right?
Yeah, I have no idea.
Yeah, like not
I just
at
thought
all.
I just thought of one more thing. You can
bonus,
pin
bonus.
You can pin videos as well. So if you're
YouTube,
brand new to Pinterest, go ahead and pin this video onto your board to get an idea of how that works.
Smart. I like that. Creative.
So you can pin videos, and so that's just another thing you can mix in, whether you have a board that's for all videos you like that are relevant, or if you mix relevant videos into other boards, just know that you can pin video too. So that's another type of pin that you can put up there.
Yep. That's it. So we just laid it down. Thank
Pinterest.
You very much.
You're
Pinterest.
Welcome.
That's how you do it. No need to buy an expensive Pinfinite course or anything like that. You can just kind of move forward with these ideas. This will get you 80-90%+ of the way there. Got to learn and adapt a little bit for sure. But I mean, the information is out there for you. If you need Board Booster, the link is in the description. If you enjoyed this video with us both, please thumbs up here in YouTube. We do appreciate it. If you haven't subscribed yet,
subscribe here.
Why
on
not?
YouTube.
Like,
why
yeah,
haven't you subscribed?
Why not?
Everyone's doing it.
And we'll get Melanie back on the channel here in a week or two. We'll have to come up with another really cool deep dive awesome topic because she is a badass marketer and we're both happy to help you become a badass marketer so you can get your message out to the world. That's our goal, is to help you get your message out. Thank you again for your time and we will see you on the next video.
Happy pinning!